Welcome to Pediheart, Pediatric Cardiology Today. My name is Dr. Robert Pass, and I'm the host of this podcast. I'm Professor of Pediatrics at the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai here in New York City. Thank you for joining me for this 294th episode of the podcast. I hope everybody enjoyed last week's episode, in which we discussed the concept of sodium glucose co-transporter 2 inhibitors for the treatment of heart failure in the adult congenital heart patient. We spoke with Dr. Anastasia Egerova of Leiden University in the Netherlands. And for those of you with an interest in novel approaches to the management of our adult congenital heart patients, I'd recommend you take a listen to last week's episode 293. As I say most weeks, if you'd like to get in touch with me, my email is easy to remember. It's pediheart@gmail.com. This week, we move on to the world of general pediatric cardiology, and the title of the interesting work we'll be reviewing is Antibiotic Prophylaxis and Infective Endocarditis Incidence Following Invasive Dental Procedures, a Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis. The first author of this work is Francesca Sperotto, and the senior author, Valeria Edifanti. And this work comes to us from multiple centers throughout the world. The first author, Dr. Sperotto, is a pediatric cardiology advanced imaging fellow at the Department of Cardiology at Boston Children's Hospital, Harvard Medical School in Boston, Massachusetts. When we're done reviewing this paper, Dr. Sperotto has kindly agreed to speak with us about it. Therefore, let's move straight on to this article and then a conversation with its first author. This week's work is on a very important and perhaps neglected topic, which is that of infective endocarditis. The authors explain that it's estimated that the global incidence ranges from 1.5 to 11.6 cases per 100,000 person years, and they also reference some literature suggesting that this incidence is actually rising over time. They explain that patients who have prosthetic heart valves, congenital heart disease, or other non-cardiac issues like those who have a central venous catheter, a hemodialysis catheter, or those who abuse IV drugs are at an elevated risk for this condition. And they remind the sobering statistic that the estimated mortality rate for infective endocarditis can be as high as 30 to 40% at 1 year. And so it would be fair to say that, as we all know, endocarditis is no joke, and its prevention is critical. The authors then review the history of antibiotic prophylaxis, and they explain how the American Heart Association first made recommendations for the prevention of endocarditis in 1955. Essentially recommending antiprophylaxis for anyone with rheumatic or congenital heart disease of any type who were undergoing dental extractions or other dental manipulations in which there would be disturbance of the gums, as well as in patients who had their tonsils or adenoids removed, or even patients in whom GI or GU surgery was planned, or even in the delivery of pregnant patients. However, times changed and recommendations did as well as a better understanding of the risks and benefits became clearer. And they remind that between 2007 and 2009, the American Heart Association and European Society of Cardiology, or ESC, as well as the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, restricted antibiotic prophylaxis, with the AHA and ESC recommending that antibiotics be given only to high-risk patients. And by this definition, these patients were patients who had a prior history of endocarditis, patients with a prosthetic heart valve or prosthetic material used in a cardiac valve repair, patients with unrepaired cyanotic heart disease, congenital heart disease with prosthetic materials or devices placed in the prior 6 months or with residual defects, and those undergoing surgical or interventional procedures who undergo an invasive dental procedure. Importantly, patients at lower risk or moderate risk were no longer recommended to take prophylaxis. Despite these recommendations, disputes still exist regarding the effectiveness of prophylaxis in prevention of endocarditis following dental procedures, and because of the controversies that still exist, the authors elected to proceed with a meta-analysis of all existing data to determine the relationship of antibiotic prophylaxis to the incidence of endocarditis following dental procedures. They explain that they explored if antibiotic prophylaxis would change infective endocarditis after dental procedures in crossover or cohort studies, as well as self-controlled case series, but also wanted to see if changes in these guidelines in 2007 to 2009 were associated with infective endocarditis incidence changes over time in so-called time trend studies. The authors then explain the methodology of this meta-analysis and how they performed a systematic search of multiple different databases, including PubMed, Cochrane, Central, Scopus, clinicaltrials.gov, and many, many other sources. They review the keywords they used and then review how they selected studies to be in this work for analysis and how the works had to include data on infective endocarditis incidence and either data on the association between prophylaxis and endocarditis following dental procedures, or it had to be a study that was a time trend analysis of infective endocarditis incidence around the time of implementation of antibiotic prophylaxis guideline implementation. They review how they assess the quality of studies so that only proper studies were included, and then how they extracted the data and performed statistical analyses. And as is often the case in this podcast, the details of this methodology are unfortunately clearly well beyond the knowledge base of this podcaster and the level of a podcast in and of itself. But for sure, I'd recommend that you read the paper for the details. And as is always the case, the link to the paper is in the show notes. And on to the results. The authors explain that they ultimately included 30 studies which had a total of 1,152,345 cases of infective endocarditis. All of the studies were observational, meaning no prospective trials. 8 were either case-control crossover or cohort studies or self-controlled case series, and 22 were time trend studies. 90% of the studies, or 27, were multicenter, with 23 of these based on national databases. And 3, or 10% of the studies, were single-center studies. And many countries in the developed world were included in these studies, mostly from the U.S. and Europe, but also from Taiwan and Canada. And so what were the most important findings of this work? First, by meta-analysis, antibiotic prophylaxis after dental procedures in individuals considered high risk, as we described earlier, was associated with a significantly low risk for infective endocarditis with a relative risk of 0.41, in other words, a 59% reduction in endocarditis with prophylaxis. Second, when looking at the time trend series, of which there were 22 studies, 19 had formal pre- and post-statistical analyses, and 9 found no significant changes in infective endocarditis incidence. 7 showed a significant increase for those at high or moderate risk, and 3 showed a significant decrease in infective endocarditis. In other words, time trend analyses were very inconsistent in their findings, with roughly 1/3 showing a significant increase after antibiotic prophylaxis was restricted in 2007 to 2009, and 2/3 showed no change or even a significant decrease in incidence. But importantly, no study showed changes in the incidence of infective endocarditis in those deemed low risk for the condition. Once again, the authors present far more data than I am presenting herein, and there are also tables with the details of the multiple studies that they utilized with their individual findings. And so again, for those interested in the granular details, please read the manuscript. In their discussion, the authors state, and I quote, "This systemic review and meta-analysis explored the role of antibiotic prophylaxis on the incidence of infective endocarditis following invasive dental procedures, bringing together data from 30 studies in 8 countries for a total of 1,152,345 infective endocarditis cases. By meta-analysis, we found that individuals at high risk who received antibiotic prophylaxis before invasive dental procedures were 59% less likely to develop endocarditis compared to those who did not receive antibiotic prophylaxis, thereby supporting current AHA and ESC recommendations. This association was not proven for individuals at moderate or low or unknown risk. In parallel, we found that the results from time trend studies were inconsistent." They explain how there's a complete absence of randomized clinical trials on this topic and how this represents a major limitation for the establishment of definitive causal relationship between prophylaxis and prevention of infection. They explain the many reasons that a randomized controlled trial is so hard to do, including things like the need for a gigantic sample size given the rarity of infective endocarditis, and how this would be very expensive and resource intensive. There's also the question of whether there is adequate clinical equipoise to ethically conduct such a study. The authors explain how prior meta-analyses found somewhat different results, but these were including far fewer studies in patients and are also missing more recent studies on this topic. They reviewed the time trend results that were mixed in regards to the effect of antibiotics on endocarditis, and they speak about the absence of good prescription data and strong knowledge of how well patients were actually taking antibiotics. And they mention how in one study they determined that only 25% of dentists were actually compliant with SPE prophylaxis recommendations. The authors explain that multiple limitations exist for this work, including many different study designs of the works that comprise this meta-analysis. They also mention the observational nature of all of the studies and the biases that this can introduce, as well as differences in infective endocarditis definition between studies. Finally, they speak of the generally increasing levels of cardiac complex patients and how this was happening simultaneously with these studies over time, also possibly affecting data in some way. And so they conclude, the findings from this study add valuable evidence in defining the role of antibiotic prophylaxis in preventing infective endocarditis following invasive dental procedures. While consistent conclusions from time trend studies are difficult to extrapolate due to their intrinsic limitations and heterogeneity, data from case control, case crossover, and cohort studies and self-controlled case series provided clearer evidence of an association between antibiotic prophylaxis and reduced infective endocarditis incidence following invasive dental procedures in individuals at high risk, while no association was proven for individuals at low or unknown risk, thereby supporting the current AHA and ESC recommendations. There are currently insufficient data to support the use of antibiotic prophylaxis in individuals at moderate risk. Overall, further studies with a rigorous scientific approach are needed. These may include pragmatic clinical trials, which, despite their acknowledged limitations, could leverage national health system data to achieve the necessary statistical power with reasonable feasibility. Well, this is an interesting topic and work, and a topic that I've not previously touched upon in the prior 293 episodes of this podcast. I've always found it of interest to learn about these recommendations regarding endocarditis and how they came to be. I well remember Dr. Michael Fried telling me how he used to sit on the AHA panel making these rules about who did and did not receive prophylaxis, and it was my impression, as Mike described it, that to a very large extent the choices for prophylaxis recommendations were based on hunches of smart cardiologists, and the reason for this was, of course, an absence of studies definitively tying the cause and effect in this disease. This work tries to address this by performing a meta-analysis and drawing in all reasonable observational data for this work. I do wonder if there will ever be a true randomized controlled trial. It would seem that at this stage, for high-risk patients, the proverbial horse has left the barn, and so it seems unlikely that we'll ever be able to safely conduct a randomized controlled trial for this group. However, for low or moderate risk patients, this might still be something that could be conclusively performed, though I'm unsure if the resources needed to perform such a study could not be better used for something else. In any event, there's much to discuss with the work's author, and so in the interest of time, let's move forward to our conversation with Dr. Sperotto. Joining us now to discuss this week's work is Dr. Francesca Sperotto. Dr. Sperotto is a graduate of the University of Padua in Italy, where she earned her MD and PhD degrees. She also completed residency in pediatrics at the same institution, as well as fellowship in pediatric critical care. Following these studies, she moved to Boston, where she completed a fellowship in pediatric cardiology at Boston Children's Hospital and is presently completing training in advanced cardiac imaging. On her LinkedIn page, she describes herself as building a career with focus at the intersection of pediatric cardiology, cardiac critical care, and advanced cardiovascular imaging, and she is a research and biostatistics enthusiast, as anyone would imagine reading this paper. It is a delight to welcome Dr. Sperotto to the podcast. Welcome, Dr. Sperotto.
I'm here now with Dr. Francesca Sperotto of Boston Children's Hospital. Dr. Sperotto, thank you very much for joining us this week on the podcast.
Thank you very much for the invite, Dr. Pass.
It's a real pleasure, and congratulations to you and all your investigators. I'm wondering, Dr. Sperotto, can you explain to the audience what type of studies have traditionally existed regarding dental prophylaxis in heart patients, and also why most of the data on this is sort of inferential and not from randomized or controlled trials? In similar vein, can you explain why your study was undertaken, you know, and what you guys hoped to determine regarding endocarditis prophylaxis from your analysis?
Of course, excellent question. Studies on antibiotic prophylaxis following invasive dental procedure in cardiac patients have primarily been observational and mostly retrospective. And we can categorize them into two main groups. The first category includes studies based on individual level data, such as case control studies, case crossover studies, self-controlled case series, or cohort studies. These studies investigate the incidence of infective endocarditis in a population at risk or in a period at risk for a given individual. And these studies generally include a wealth of clinical information and detailed statistical analysis, which often account for confounding factors. The second category consists of time trend studies, which are population-level epidemiological studies that examine the trends in the incidence of an event over time, and often in relation to an intervention. In the case of infective endocarditis, they assess changes in incidence over time related to the release of guidelines on antibiotic prophylaxis. These studies generally include fewer clinical details, make more assumptions, and the statistical analyses are often limited and heterogeneous. And it's important to note, as you pointed out, Dr. Bass, that this list of studies does not include any randomized controlled trial. And this is mostly due to major challenges in conducting this type of study for this research question. First, data have shown that hundreds of patients would need to be given antibiotic prophylaxis to prevent one case of endocarditis. And on top of that, infective endocarditis is a rare event. So a large sample size of thousands of patients would be required to achieve adequate statistical power.
Yeah.
And this significantly impacts the feasibility of a trial, both in terms of costs and organizational resources.
Yeah.
And last but not least, there are major ethical concerns regarding withholding antibiotic prophylaxis from population at risk, such as patient high risk. Mm. And in the absence of randomized controlled trials, synthesizing the existing evidence from observational studies becomes particularly important. And this was the main rationale for undertaking our systematic review and meta-analysis.
Well, that was a wonderful summary. Thank you very much, Dr. Sperotto. I think everybody's going to much better understand things than my very basic description that precedes this interview. So thank you very much. I'm wondering, Dr. Sperotto, I'll often ask a guest if they could maybe summarize for the audience what you believe are the three or four most important findings from your analysis.
Yes, of course. With this work, I think we were able to put together results from different individual-based studies to generate higher-level evidence on the association between antibiotic prophylaxis and infective endocarditis following invasive dental procedure. Through random effects meta-analysis, we found that individuals had high risk, for example, those with a prosthetic valve or those with congenital heart disease with significant residual defects, who received antibiotic prophylaxis before invasive dental procedure, were 59% less likely to develop infective endocarditis compared to those who did not receive antibiotic prophylaxis. And this confirmed that antibiotic prophylaxis has a benefit in this category of patients and should be given before any invasive dental procedures. And on the other hand, no association was found for patients at low risk. As such, these data support the current recommendations of the American Heart Association and the European Society of Cardiology. Additionally, this data should likely represent a call for action to update some national guidelines which do not recommend routine antibiotic prophylaxis in high-risk patients. And finally, we documented that for patients at moderate risk, such as those with acquired valvular heart disease, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and most other congenital heart disease not considered high risk, there is currently insufficient evidence to suggest that antibiotic prophylaxis is effective. And likely further studies are needed to clarify the role of prophylaxis in this category of patients.
I see. Very interesting. You know, I was not aware that there are countries where high-risk patients are not recommended to take antibiotic prophylaxis. Where is that the case?
For example, the NICE guidelines are currently not recommending antibiotic prophylaxis as a routine practice. So there's
interesting.
Of course, a call for a change in that.
Yeah, absolutely. Dr. Sperotto, you spoke a little bit about this already, but can you explain to the audience your theory on why your meta-analysis of case control and crossover or cohort studies or self-controlled case series pretty clearly demonstrated benefit for antibiotic prophylaxis in the high-risk patient, but your time trend study analysis did not? You have any thoughts on that?
Yes, as mentioned, while individual-based studies generally include a substantial amount of patient-level clinical information and more detailed statistical analysis, Time trial studies, which are population-based, tend to have fewer clinical details, and their statistical analyses are often limited and maybe very heterogeneous. And on top of that, results from this type of studies may be inconsistent also for other reasons. For example, most of these studies did not include prescription data and simply assumed adherence to guidelines. However, in a recent studies that collected evidence from 20 countries, we found that only 25% of dentists were compliant with current guidelines, either under or over prescribing. Therefore, the assumption that antibiotic prophylaxis was given and was given correctly was likely not true. And we also could not rule out that any changes in the incidence of the infective endocarditis over time might have been driven also by other factors that changed concurrently during the study period, such as an improvement in the diagnosis of infective endocarditis or an increased number of prosthetic valve placements. As a further but very important point, the statistical analysis in these studies vary from segmental regressions to interval rate ratio analysis to change point analysis. And this significant heterogeneity precluded any further meta-analysis on these type of studies. To put it another way, it would have been like comparing apples to oranges, and we certainly did not want to do that.
Okay, well, thank you for dumbing that down for us, for those of us who aren't as good in the statistics. That was great. Thank you. Well, for those in the audience, it's right at the start of Dr. Sperotto's day, so I'm going to try to wrap it up here. You know, in your discussion, you suggest that further studies are needed to more definitively determine the answer to the question of who, if anyone, should receive prophylaxis. I was thinking to myself that given the power of your meta-analysis with, you know, literally millions of patients, why do you believe this form of a prospective assessment of this topic might still be helpful? And do you think that there is even adequate equipoise to perform a randomized controlled trial looking at SP prophylaxis in either the high or moderate risk category patients? And maybe you could share with us, what do we not know well enough about prophylaxis in regards to the dental patient?
This is an excellent question, Dr. Pass. So for high-risk patients, I believe our work confirmed that there is no equipoise between antibiotic prophylaxis and no antibiotic prophylaxis before an invasive dental procedure. And conducting a randomized controlled trial in this patient category would not be ethical at this point. However, there is still much to understand about the moderate risk category of patients. And these patients are known to have a significant higher risk of developing infective endocarditis than the general healthy population. But it has yet to be proven that antibiotic prophylaxis significantly decreased that risk, at least consistently. So further studies are certainly needed to clarify this aspect. And given the major challenges in performing a randomized controlled trial in this setting, which I've mentioned before, I think we should look ahead and start exploring other strategies to answer this research question. And these may include either novel adaptive trial designs or pragmatic clinical trials, which, despite their acknowledged limitations, could leverage national health system data to achieve the necessary statistical power with a reasonable feasibility. And I also believe this approach might be feasible only through collaborations, which was also fundamental to our project. And I was fortunate to work with an international and multidisciplinary panel.
Yes.
And it was this diversity of skills and expertise that made our efforts possible and valuable. And with this in mind, if you would allow me, I would like to thank all the authors and acknowledge the strong support of the World Workshop of Oral Medicine, that is an international initiative focused on identifying and possibly answering a research question through international expert collaborations. And we hope we did a good job.
Well, thank you for that. And again, let me reemphasize congratulations to you and the many, many co-authors of this work. Really a wonderful work, very helpful and very practical. Dr. Sperotto, thank you very much for joining us this week on the podcast.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's a great pleasure. Thank you.
Well, I'm sure that you now have a much better understanding of Dr. Sperotto's work after speaking directly with her. I found her comments on the differences between time trend studies and more patient-centered studies like case control studies to be of great interest. I also thought that her comments about why it would still be important to consider studying this topic in regards to the moderate risk patient to be important. and also found her thoughts about why such a study is so difficult to successfully perform, given the low prevalence of this disease, to be helpful in understanding why this is a topic that has been so vexing to properly study. Once again, I'd like to thank her for taking time out of her very busy schedule as a fellow to speak with us this week. To conclude this 294th episode of Pediheart Pediatric Cardiology today, we hear the wonderful French-Canadian tenor Leopold Simoneau, who was a native of Quebec. Mr. Simoneau is considered one of the great lyric tenors of the 20th century, whose voice was notable for beauty and sweetness, and who was extraordinarily stylish in his singing. He was particularly well known for his Mozart singing, and today we'll hear a bit of that when he sings in this old recording the aria Un aura amoroso from Act I of Mozart's Così fan tutte. Thank you very much for joining me this week, and thanks again to Dr. Sperotto. I hope all have a great week ahead.